They put us all on mute. Okay.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And we welcome you to Haus Church this morning. And here are these daylilies. Is that what they are?
Asiatic lilies.
They are so beautiful, smell lovely. And we just want to show them off to you and give thanks to God for blessing us with such beauty all around. Just look outside. But right now we want to look inside by giving our attention to the Lord within us, beyond us, beside us. And David Miranda will be leading us in an opening prayer. David?
Okay. Good morning, Haus Church. Join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for these brothers and sisters that are here now to just hear your word, Father, to see what you want to teach us today. Open our ears, open our eyes. Father, I ask that you be with Bart as he gives a message. Thank you, God, that we can get together and we can pray and listen to your word and pray for the needs of our church, God. Ask you be with us today, give us a great day, and bless this time we have with each other. Father, we pray this in the name of your son. Amen.
Jason.
Huh? Okay, so I guess who's going to be coming up? Well, I don't guess. I know. But it's me and my son, Jason, who's visiting here from school. And he was volunteered by my wife to sing a song for us. So
he started, he goes to Stanford and he is in, he's a wrestler as well. And he, Josh, our older son, he's like always played very comfortable with the guitar and had a little, even made a little, album on YouTube, iTunes. And anyway, Jason, this is kind of new for him, but he goes to the Crew Fellowship.
FCA.
I'm sorry, FCA, Fellowship of Christian Athletes. And they were like, hey, does anybody know how to play guitar? We need someone to lead worship. And Jason's like, I kind of play guitar. So he's like, okay. And anyway, the next thing they know, they're like, Jason, you got to take this song. You're leading. And he's, I've never done this before. Like, I don't, anyway, he just went out on a limb and, you know, he played for us on his birthday and we're like, Jason, you've gotten so much better. So I asked him if he'd play and he said he would. So he's drinking some water to kind of,
yeah. Okay.
Anyway, here comes our darling son, Jason.
Ready?
Yeah.
All right.
Get up.
All right. I can go here. How's it going, everyone? Good morning. Like I said, my name's Jason. And I just woke up like 15 minutes ago, so I'm a little tired. My voice is a little bit scraggly, but
is it normal?
Yeah. This song that I'm gonna play, it's called 17. It's kind of like to me, it's like a prayer to God. It's like this guy is kind of struggling with trying to like break through from sin and feels like he can't really figure it all out. And so that's what it's going to be about. And forgive me if my voice kind of starts to crack a little bit, because like I said, my voice, I just woke up, so struggling a little bit. But anyways.
Here I am confessing again, I know I've let you down. I've said a thousand times, never again starts now. I've slept through so many days, I've wasted so much time. Can't solve it with a song, can't fix it with a rhyme, so I'll try. With myself again, but I can feel just so uncomfortable in my skin. No, you told me that you love me, but I don't remember when. Oh, feel like I was so much wiser when I was 17. I saw the world in just two shades and stand in the in-between. If the man I was back then saw who I am right now, I wonder if he'd be disappointed in how he would turn out. So I'll try to be honest with myself again. But I can feel just so uncomfortable in my skin. No, you told me that you loved me, but I don't remember when. Oh, 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 oh. But I hear you say, child, stop listening to yourself so much. I've made you more than worthy of my love. You are fearfully and wonderfully made, and that's enough. Oh, 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 child. If you could see yourself the way that I do, you'd see I've made you in my image, and my words not through. Oh, we'll dance on this disappointment in a world made new. Oh, 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 oh.
Called Bright Spot on Sundays, where it's kind of like at the end of the news segment where it's good news story. I just want you to know that you're my bright spot, and I have a feeling I'm talking for everybody. To see a young kid, and your mom's right, you are adorable, but to see a young kid who is in college, a wrestler, and you love the Lord, and you're sharing that gift, that is just such an inspiration to all of us. So thank you for being our bright spot today.
Absolutely, absolutely. Hey, and I have another bright spot, and I'm seeing him on the screen as you are also, and that is Steve Taylor. Steve.
Good morning.
Steve is waving from St. Louis. I told you all a couple of weeks ago. Was it last week or the week? It was just two weeks ago when I was telling you about my experience in St. Louis.
At the airport.
Yeah. And yeah. At the airport, I met Steve in the prayer room. He was in there reading. And yeah. I told you guys the story. And if you weren't there to hear it then, just a little bit of a recap. I saw Steve in there. He's a baggage handler with Southwest Airlines, and he goes in the prayer room to study the scripture. And we got into a wonderful conversation. We prayed together. We hugged together. Yeah. We just had a delightful time. Steve, that was a bright spot for me. Anything to add from St. Louis there, brother?
Yeah, I just want to thank God for meeting you. It's been exciting ever since. And I just thank God for meeting you. It was a joyous time having with you. And I told my family the same thing. Yeah.
What a delight to see you right now. And Steve, he's involved in a church over there and he was studying. I remember it was, I think, Acts chapter 16.
Acts chapter 3.
Acts chapter 3, and we were talking about that, and it's just wonderful to see you, brother.
Yes, thank you.
Wonderful.
Nice to meet you, Steve.
Hey.
Nice to meet you, everyone.
Do we have another bright spot out there, brothers and sisters? Somebody to share something. Craig, you got one?
Yeah, I've got one. You know, our God is so awesome, right? And you think about coincidences. So my wife and I are going to be going to a wedding. And that wedding is going to be in Nairobi. And we've been sponsoring a child from Hope Chests that lives in Africa. So Sally says to me, wouldn't it be awesome if we could go see Nikodu, N-I-K-D-U? You know, he writes us letters and we write him letters and we've corresponded now for all these years. And Sally says, yeah, you know, but Craig, Africa is a big place. I don't know where he is in Africa. I mean, it's huge. And I said, well, yeah, but let's check it out. Let's see. So we're going to fly into Kenya. So we start doing some research, and Nikodu's in the province of Kenya. So we're going to be staying in Nairobi. Well, we did some more research, and Nikodu is in the province of Nairobi. So we did a little bit more from the hotel and found out that the school is 45 minutes away from where we're going to be.
Look at that. Wow.
And when we go to Africa, the people that we're staying with are from Africa. They go to Sally's church and their daughter's getting married. So we have guides. So first we contacted the school and the school said, it's a really, really rough part of town. Why don't we just bring them to the hotel? And we said, fine, that'll work. And then we talked to Emmanuel, who's the missionary from Africa here. He said, no. We got to go to the school. So Emmanuel gets a hold of the school. Anyway, we're going to be meeting Nikodu in person at the end of October. So praise God. You know, and you know, you just think about the odds. If you were a gambling man and you said, well, what's the odds of this man being 45 minutes from where we're going to land in this big country?
Yeah.
Only God can arrange that. So that's my bright spot.
I love it. Fantastic. Hey, can we get another? I love it. We're on a roll now. Can we get another bright spot out there? Well, speaking of Africa, let's put Brother Flavian on the spot. Flavian, with your lovely family. Naomi and Jimmy James and Maria, you got a bright spot for us today, Flavian.
Yeah, thanks so much, Bart. I'm glad to see Brother Steve. Hello, Brother Steve. I'm Flavian. This is my wife, Naomi, my daughter, Maria, and my son, Jimmy James. We are living in the DRC, Democratic Republic of Congo. In Central Africa, we are staying especially in the town of Goma, in east of our country, DRC. I'm glad to see Brother Steve, and you are my first bright spot today. My second is to praise God for his blessings for us from DI. And we are thankful to you, Bart and Don, and all the House Church and the DI members for blessing us both spiritually and financially. Our bright spot is to ask Father God to bless you abundantly and keep you healthy. And I was glad to be with my family members last Sunday. As you saw it, my family, we were with my sister's family, Sister Bertil, Betty's family and my brother Artie's family. We were together with all our children. We enjoyed a wonderful time together. We shared the word of God together. We prayed together. We shared a meal together. So we enjoyed a really wonderful time together. And I praise Father God for letting us meeting with my sister coming from Bukavu. So I was very glad to see her. And she is my only sister that I have from my mother's womb. So that is my bright spot.
Thanks very much, Flavian. It's such a delight when we gather together our small group to have our indigenous missionaries that we support, Flavian and his family in DRC, and also Patrick and Mervis in Malawi, who are not with us today, but have celebrated recently planting their 33rd church in Malawi, which is really awesome. Awesome.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Let's go ahead and move into our prayer time. Tom Thompson from Colorado is going to lead us through our prayer as Heidi, you bring those prayer requests and the scripture readings onto our screen.
Good morning, Haus Church. I invite you all to take this time to pray with me to our Father in heaven. Lord, we want to praise you and thank you for numerous things today, that you are such a great God and that you take care of us and watch out for each one of us. We'd like to thank you for Joan's recovery from COVID and for her safe travels for her family with her granddaughter's move. We want to thank you for the 33rd Church, the Regions recently started in Malawi, with continued growth in the Lord and provision and care. Lord, we bring some needs before you this morning. We think of the problem with the nuclear power plant in Ukraine and pray that it would be resolved without any radiation leakage or injuries to people. We pray for the catastrophic flooding in Pakistan that killed over 1,000 and caused considerable damage to property and the infrastructure there. We pray for your protection of DRC citizens from attacks by the armed rebels and for relief from the adverse impact on the DRC economy. We pray for the government in Malawi to address the ongoing and unmet needs of and the unrest of its citizens quickly and completely. We pray for a successful general conference of churches in Malawi at the end of October, and for your provisions for supplies for this meeting. We pray for Heidi's friend, Angela, who needs relief from pain after starting chemo following a multiple myeloma diagnosis. We just think of those who are in need of medical assistance, Lord. Be with them. We pray for Bobby Bennett and his family as they grieve the loss of his cousin, who left behind a wife and a baby daughter. Comfort them, Lord, and be with them. We pray for Bobby's safe travels to his cousin's funeral in Pennsylvania, and that they will have a meaningful time with family members. We think of John and Pam Holt, Lord, as they continue to address the issues relating to serious water damage to their home. Guide them and direct them and provide for their needs, Lord. We pray for Mary Miranda to continue to have success in her Marine Basic Training School in Quantico. Guide and direct her, Lord, and protect her. For the safety and wisdom, care, and the care of teachers and children as they begin a new school year. Lord, we pray for Haus Church to shine the light of God's love in Christ to all of us. Lord, just be with each person in this meeting this morning. Direct our steps, and we thank you for all you've done. In Jesus' name. Would you all join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Our scripture will be read this morning from Lynn Songy right here in Maryland. Lynn.
Thank you. This reading is from Genesis chapter 16, verses 1 through 6. Abram's wife, Sarai, had not borne any children for him, but she owned an Egyptian slave named Hagar. Sarai said to Abram, since the Lord has prevented me from bearing children, go to my slave. Perhaps through her, I can build a family. Abram agreed to what Sarai said. So Abram's wife, Sarai, took Hagar, her Egyptian slave, and gave her to her husband, Abram, as a wife for him. He slept with Hagar, and she became pregnant. When Hagar realized that she was pregnant, she treated her mistress with contempt. Then Sarai said to Abram, you are responsible for my suffering. I put my slave in your arms, and ever since she saw that she was pregnant, she has treated me with contempt. May the Lord judge between me and you. Abram replied to Sarai, here, your slave is in your hands. Do what you want with her. Sarai mistreated Hagar and so much that she ran away from her. This reading is from Acts chapter 15, verses 36 through 40. Paul said to Barnabas, let's go back and visit the brothers in every town where we have preached the message of the Lord and see how they're doing. Barnabas wanted to take along John Mark, but Paul did not think it appropriate to take along this man who had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not gone on with them to the work. There was such a sharp disagreement that they parted company, and Barnabas took Mark with him and sailed off to Cyprus. Then Paul chose Silas and departed after being commended to the grace of the Lord by the brothers.
Thank you for those readings, Lynn. And I want us to think about what Hagar felt. Do you think she felt that she was kicked to the curb by Sarai? And what about John Mark? Do you think that he felt like he was kicked to the curb by Paul? Have you ever felt kicked to the curb? It's our word for today. Think about it. If you've ever been kicked to the curb, know that he knows how you feel. Talking about the Lord Jesus. Psalm 9, verse 13 says, be kind to me, God. I've been kicked around long enough. Let's pray. Father, sometimes we feel like we've been kicked around long enough. And in this moment, maybe we can reflect on times that we've felt that we've been kicked to the curb. Or perhaps we've been the kicker and kicked somebody there for whatever reasons that we thought were justified in the moment. But Lord, help us to not only be mindful of those experiences that we have felt and these figures from antiquity to relate to, but how should we respond? How did you respond? Help us to learn from the examples that you give us, especially the example of your life, Lord Jesus, on this earth, where we live and where we experience life just as you did. In your name we pray, amen. Well, Heidi, I'd like you to pull up a poll. We're going to do a poll, and it's about being kicked to the curb, and there's some choices. about this. So there it is. Go ahead and submit your response. Kick to the curb. What does it mean? Does it mean getting fired from a job? Does it mean being uninvited to a party? Does it mean someone breaking up with you? All of the above, or maybe none of the above. So as you're getting those responses, Heidi, you decide when you want to show us the results after they've come in. So kick to the curb, all kinds of reasons, some of those given. Getting fired, ever been fired from a job? I have. Anybody else? Uninvited to a party? Anybody being uninvited? Anybody have someone break up with you and you felt kicked to the curb? Are all of these reasons for feeling kicked to the curb, or none of them? You have a response yet, Heidi? There it is. All of the above. Well, getting fired from a job, I guess that not necessarily. Nobody responded to that one. 7% on being uninvited to a party, felt that way, or breaking up with you. But all of the above seems to be the response. And yet 14% said none. I'd like to hear those responses at some point. All right. Well, let's think about what it really means to be kicked to the curb, okay? Does it mean getting fired from a job? I would say not necessarily. Now, if you're fired from a job for no good cause, or at least the way you see it is no good cause, that might be a reason. But sometimes people deserve to be fired from a job, don't they? So not necessarily. How about being uninvited to a party? Maybe. But what if they just forgot? They just forgot. Maybe didn't even make an apology afterwards, but it was just not because there was anything that they felt was wrong with you. They just forgot. Or how about a breakup in a relationship? Well, sometimes that needs to happen. And maybe there's a good reason. So there's all kinds of extenuating issues, aren't there? But let's think about it this way. What does it really mean to be kicked to the curb? I want you to think about when you take out the garbage. I did that this morning, and there's a bin behind our building, and we throw it in there, and I don't want it back. That's what it means, I think, to be kicked to the curb. You kick your garbage to the curb because it's of no use, no value to you. You don't want it back. It's garbage. So when you feel kicked to the curb, it's because whomever did the kicking thinks that you're just not worth keeping. And they don't want you back. Is that the way Hagar felt? It must have been, I think. As we go back to that story found in Genesis, Hagar. You know, the name Hagar means flight, forsaken. Flight, yeah, she left. Why? Because she felt forsaken. I imagine that name connection to Hagar came after those events happened to this woman. Did you know in America, the word Hagar, the name Hagar, is number, I think it's about 9,468 in the most popular names in America. There's less than 2,500 people in America with the name Hagar. In other words, it's not a popular name. Yeah, well, what happened to this poor woman? Well, let's go back into the scriptures where we see God calling Abram to go to this country that he didn't know, and he would bless him and make him a great nation. Abram was 75 years old. He didn't know how God was going to do it, but he does leave, and by faith he goes south, and he travels into the land of Canaan. And he gets down to a place in Shechem, and then south of Shechem, to Bethel. Bethel means house of God. And there he makes an altar to God because God appears to him and says, I'm going to make you a great nation. It's like, okay, great, stay here. But he doesn't stay there. He goes south of the Negev into the desert, and there's a famine in the land. And what does Abram do? He leaves to find food, wouldn't you? But maybe he should have just stayed, because that was the land that God had called him to. And he made the promise there. But he goes down to Egypt. And in Egypt, he finds food, but he also finds a challenge there, because his wife, who happens to be 65 years old, she's a good-looking woman. My wife is 65 years old. She's a good-looking woman. Pharaoh was interested in her. And so he says, well, it's just my sister. It's not really my wife. Well, actually, they were related, and he could technically call her a sister, but he was really escaping the fact that, well, if I'm identified as her husband, Pharaoh may want her and then kill me. And so, you know, he goes through all that. And what happens is he eventually gets out of Egypt, because Pharaoh kicks him out when he finds out what has happened, but he kicks him out with a lot of prosperity as well, to include, evidently, Hagar as a maidservant to his wife, Sarai. Why? Because she was Egyptian. That's obviously where she came from. And over the next 10 years, Hagar is there as Sarai's handmaiden. She's her slave. She belongs to Sarai. We assume that they have a good relationship. We don't have any cause to think otherwise. So it's almost 10 years later when God appears to Abram and he says, I am going to promise you a great nation. And Abram's going, how? The heir to my lineage is not even my own. Eliezer from Damascus. He's not even my own child. He's from my family. No, God says, I'm going to do this. Well, it's probably within the next year or two that Abram is now 85 years old, and his wife is 75 years old, and wondering, how is this going to happen? And Sarai has an idea. Well, I'll give you my handmaiden, Hagar, and she will be your wife and have a child, hopefully through her. And then that will fulfill God's promise that the child would come from you. And that's what happens. But then it blows up. And if you've got your Bible, I'm looking right now at chapter 16, verse 3 and following. So to follow along with me, it says, Abram had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan. This is after leaving Egypt, and his wife Sarai took Hagar, the Egyptian, who belonged to her, her maid, and gave her to her husband Abram as his wife. She had the authority to do it. Abram was happy to receive her. Maybe he can have a child through her, and that's what happens. He went into Hagar, had sexual relations, and she conceived. And when Hagar saw that she had conceived, it says her mistress was despised in her sight. That's all it says, but what must that have looked like? Maybe it looked like this. Nah, I got the baby and you don't. I don't know. It must have been something like that, but it infuriated Sarai. Why? Come on, woman. You gave Hagar to your husband for this purpose, has a baby, and now you're upset about that? Notice what she does. Sarai said to Abram, may the wrong done to me be upon you. Now she's blaming her husband, for goodness sakes. I gave my maid into your arms, but when she saw that she had conceived, I was despised in her sight. May the Lord judge between me and you as to who's right. Wow, this is some really family drama going on here. It got so bad that Hagar leaves. Wouldn't you? She's out there on her own now, but she's not on her own, and she's not alone. God appears to her and makes a promise to her. You will have a son. He will become a great nation. But here's what I want you to do, and here's what we need to think about, which is really a tough one, I think. When we feel like we've been kicked to the curb, what do we do? What would you do? Think about when you felt kicked to the curb. God says to Hagar, go back to Sarai and submit to her. Wow. And you know what she does? Exactly that. And you know what happens? She raises that son, and Abram loves him and assumes that he will be the next generation. But that's not the end of the story. You see, it's another 13 years. Now Ishmael is 13, he's reached manhood, and God is now ready to make that promise good. Abram, he can't believe it. Sarai, she can't believe it, but it happens. And when it happens, and the boy is born, Isaac, which means laughter. Very interesting. The name means laughter. Sarah laughed. She laughed when she heard that she was going to have a son in her old age. Laughed. But then when the son was born, then she laughed in a whole different ways. You know, there's different kinds of laughter that we can have. Well, when Isaac, it says, was weaned, and by this time, Ishmael is probably 15 years old. Listen to this. This is in chapter 21. It says, now Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, laughing. The translation I have says mocking. Laughing at whom? Maybe laughing at this little boy who had just been born. Ishmael is thinking, I'm the guy. So if you will, the way Hagar responded to Sarai that led to her being booted out, or at least feeling like she had to leave, is happening here again with Ishmael. And you know what happens? Sarai, now named Sarah, wants them both out. And Abraham, the father of a multitude, now Abram to Abraham, the father of many, doesn't want that to happen, but he allows it. And Hagar leaves with Ishmael. And you kind of have to read the rest of the story, but you know, it's like getting kicked out twice and they don't come back. So how do you feel when you get kicked to the curb? How has it felt to you? And how have you responded afterwards? That's the application point. One more story from the scriptures, actually two more, but this one from Acts. And his name is John Mark. Now, Saul, who becomes Paul, really is through a friend. And the friend is named Joseph, but he's given another name, Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He's a fantastic guy, such an encourager. He's the one who goes on behalf of this guy, Saul, who has this amazing conversion. And he speaks on his behalf to the Christian leaders, the Apostle Peter and some of the others. He says, this guy really has had this happen to him because nobody wanted to receive him because of Saul's prior background. But Barnabas does, and they become very, very close friends. And eventually God calls them to go on a missionary journey. Now, Barnabas is from Cyprus, an island. And when they leave on that first missionary journey, they go to Cyprus first and they travel the extent of the island. And John Mark is with them. Now, John Mark, and that's probably the way he went by the name John and Mark. John probably being more the Hebrew name, and sometimes people had two. And the Greek name, perhaps Mark, but together it was John or Mark or John Mark. That was the cousin of Barnabas. And they're traveling together and they go across the island. And by the time they get to the other side of the island, the language really changes about the leadership of this missionary team from Barnabas and Saul, now called Paul, to Paul and Barnabas. And when they leave the island to go to the mainland, in southern what's now Turkey, John Mark goes back home. We're not told why, but we can infer what the reason is by what happens later on. So much later, after that first missionary journey is over, Barnabas and Paul are talking, and Paul says, hey, you know what? We ought to go visit those places that we visited before. And Barnabas says, yeah, that's a great idea. Let's go. And I want to take John Mark with us. And Paul says, no way. We're not going to take him with us. He deserted us the last time, which gives us a window into what might have happened. Maybe it was just too much for that young man at the time. And he says, wow, this is too intense. Paul was a pretty intense guy. Just read the scriptures in the book of Acts on those missionary journeys. And he goes back. Well, the discussion became so heated that they parted company. These two men, such good friends over the issue of a person. It wasn't over the issue of doctrine, what we believe, but over relationships. And so often that is what happens to folks that are getting kicked to the curb. If you have been, like I have been, it's oftentimes because of a broken relationship somewhere. And what happens is two missionary journeys follows. What's really, really interesting is that Barnabas takes John Mark and they head in the same direction as the first journey, which is what Paul wanted to do with Barnabas. They head back over to Cyprus. It's almost like I think Barnabas is saying, hey, let's do a do-over. John Mark, I want to give you another chance. I admire him for that. And yet the scriptures go on to say that the church affirmed what Paul was doing with Silas on the next missionary journey. They don't say that they affirmed what Barnabas was doing, although they may have, but it's not there, but they do affirm Paul. So if you read some commentators, they say Paul had a good reason to do what he did, but you be the judge of that. What happened was they both go in opposite directions and Paul heads west, and he goes through his own town first before he starts to visit some of the other churches. We don't know if Barnabas and Paul ever got together again. Paul does mention him a few years later in a letter to the church in Corinth, and not a negative sort of way, but he just mentions him by name. But it's likely that they did not team up again because of that. That's sad. But here's a good news story. And we don't know the in-between of it, but we do know in the very last letter recorded by the Apostle Paul in Scripture shortly before he was executed. Just read the book and you'll know that in 2 Timothy, it looks like his timeline is short. At the last chapter, toward the very end, Paul says, Luke is the only one with me. Please send me the parchments and the cloaks. And this is what I need. And also send Mark because he will be of use to me. Somehow there was a restoration in that relationship. That's beautiful. So how did that happen? Well, we don't know. But what I want us to think about and talk about now for a moment is a time when you felt like you were kicked to the curb. What did it feel like? And what did you do about it? Who wants to share? Nobody has ever felt like you were kicked the curb. Okay, Heidi, please.
I don't know how many, 5 years ago or so, my girlfriend was going through a divorce and it was a terrible situation. She made some very, very, very poor choices in her life. And I was the only friend that stood by her and just brought her, you know, to church, prayed for her. We walked together, invited her to another friend's Bible study. And so she came. Well, the lady that was having the Bible study grew contempt towards my friend. And after the Bible study, you could just tell she just felt very uncomfortable around her, having her in her home, do the choices that my friend had made. And the Bible study came to an end. And then they had another Bible study, which my niece was a part of as well. She was, and turns out they didn't invite me and my other friend to the Bible study. And they kept it a secret from us. And it really devastated me. And I did not really know how to handle that. Wow, isn't that where we're supposed to be for people as a church, for people who are in their darkest hour, to include them and not exclude them? And I was pushed out because I associated myself with a sinner. And I confronted my other friend and I said, wow, I can't understand this. And she couldn't really explain herself other than the fact that she just said, oh no, you were invited. And, you know, I said, no, I clearly wasn't. Anyway, it really devastated me. And it's still like one of those spots in my heart that is kind of scabbed over, I guess you'd say. And I just pray that I never treat people like that. And that as a church and as a community of Christians, that I can be inclusive. And not that you're accepting the sin, but that you're accepting the sinner in your home and to love them unconditionally and show them God's love. And I felt like this person who I really admired for a long time, it really changed my point of view for towards her, which is also something I have to kind of forgive her for. So that's kind of where my struggle has been, is forgiving this girl for kicking us to the curb. So that's my.
Okay. So what's been the outcome of that, Heidi? Has that relationship been restored?
Between the girl that kicked us out of the Bible study, she moved away to Texas. So I confronted her and let her know my pain, you know, that it was painful. She never apologized at all. So it was kind of hard to actually move forward and heal. It was kind of one of those things where there's no hatred or there's no, you know, she comes to town, we see each other, we're friendly. I loved her boys. Her boys wrestled with my boys. I don't know. It's just, there's never been any like, hey, let's move forward as friends. But it's okay. You know, I mean, she's not a close, they live far away. So it's just.
So it really never has been restored. And I'm guessing that really? Whenever you think of her, you can't help but remember that.
Very true.
Yeah, very true.
Absolutely. And I don't like to feel that way, but I do.
Yeah.
It's kind of like ick.
Okay. Well, thanks for sharing that, Heidi, because this brings it to life for us, doesn't it? We can talk about Hagar. We could talk about John Mark. But how about our own experiences, what it felt like and how we've responded to it? Or maybe what we still need to do, or maybe we can't. Somebody else. Okay, I'll call on my wife.
Oh,
she hates it when I do that.
What story? What story? Okay, so I can remember one. I was working for a brand new internet startup company. I had been recruited, and I was going to be the manager of all of customer service. And everything was fine for about the first 6 months. And I got to work really early one morning, and we were at the cubicle stage of life when everybody was in a cubicle behind, so you couldn't really see who was in. So I got in really early, first one in. I was working, and two of my reps walked in, and they didn't know I was in there, and they started just talking dirt. And it got to be very catty, where they were talking about everybody in the office. And I just stood up, leaned over the cubicle, and I said, if you guys don't have anything nice to say, you shouldn't say anything at all. And this girl, who I had just hired about 2-3 months before, looked at me and she said, who's talking to you, big ears? And I'm the boss of the whole department. So I told her she needed to get her coat and she needed to go home. That isn't the kick to the curb part. The kick to the curb part was, she refused to go home, so I had to get my boss. My boss came in and was very sweet and tender, and this girl went home. They brought her back about 6 months later, kicking me to the curb by putting her right back in position under me, where I had to deal with her. And she just carried on right where she had 6 months before. And so I told my boss, if you can't move her, I'm going to have to quit my job, because I was just going to make a point. And he kicked me to the curb. So I left my job. So.
Wow. Wow. That was a good one off the cuff. Not a good one, but a bad one. And you know, these things don't always have a happy ending. Sometimes they go on, but let's do one more story of being kicked to the curb. And it has to do with the Lord Jesus. God really knows how to relate to us in every aspect of life. He comes into the world, the perfect human being, the embodiment of love, the commandments kept perfectly. And yet, he was rejected, despised, humiliated. Just read Isaiah chapter 53 of the suffering servant. It is remarkable, written hundreds of years, perhaps 700 years before Jesus came onto the scene. And there, at about 30 years of age, he enters into public service. Before that, his life is unblemished. After that, it's unblemished, but it is looked upon in a way that the blemishes just fill up the entire viewfinder of the person of Jesus by the religious authorities, even family members and friends. Why? Because he speaks the truth, because he touches the untouchable, because he communicates the essence of the gospel as communicated throughout the scriptures about what it really looks like to love God with all your being and love your neighbor as yourself. He lives it, and yet he is rejected. He is crucified. He is kicked to the curb. So when you feel what you've expressed, some of you, Heidi just did, Dawn did, I could tell stories, some of the rest of you can also. Let's look to the Lord and say, how did he feel? How do we feel? Well, he felt much like we feel. He probably felt very much abandoned. No doubt he did feel abandoned, thoroughly abandoned, even abandoned by the Father, for he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? But how did he respond? See, this is what's important for us, I think, to take away. It's not that it doesn't happen to us. It does happen to us for various reasons, that we feel kicked to the curb, or maybe we're the one doing the kicking. But whatever the case may be, when it happens, it feels bad, it hurts a lot, and we want to hurt back, don't we? Don't you? What did God say to Hagar? He said, go back to her. Wow. What about John Mark? Somehow that relationship got restored. We don't know exactly how, but it's a beautiful ending. But quite often that doesn't happen. How does it play out in the life of Jesus? How does it? Well, in Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is saying many things about the law. He says, you've heard that it was said, you know, don't commit murder, but I say if you hate in your heart, you've already done it. He really pushes the law to the limit. And in one part, toward the very end of chapter 5, he says, you have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemy. Pray for those who persecute you. And then at the very last verse, he climaxes that statement by saying, therefore, you are to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Perfect means complete, the way we were created and designed to be by God in the beginning, before sin entered in the picture. And yet he has come to redeem us, to purchase us back to himself, and to empower us to live the right life through his Spirit, if we let him by faith. And that is the perfect life that he has called us to and empowers us to. You are to be that way, just as your Father is that way. And then Jesus lives it out to the death. When he is being crucified, when he is literally being nailed to the cross, he cries out, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. So when those kinds of things happen to us, how about we respond the same way? And I can tell you myself, I can't do it my own strength. I want vengeance. I want vindication. Well, vengeance is mine, says the Lord, not Bart. The vindication comes from God, not us. So how about we just respond in the manner of Jesus, in the manner of Hagar responding to what God called her to do? Go back. Or Heidi doing whatever she could. Maybe they don't respond back the way you would hope, but you've done what you could. Because Jesus, when he said, forgive them, they went through it. They went and continued to murder him and put him on the cross. But he still held that out, that opportunity for reconciliation and restoration. And if he did that for us and empowers us to be that way, who are we to deny the Lord to do what he desires to do in us and through us? Well, let's come now with that to the Lord's table to celebrate with the one who gave his life that we might have life. Because when he says, forgive them, they know not what they do, he was speaking to you and me too. We are the ones who put him on the cross. And he still desires to have fellowship with us, calls us into a relationship with him, a relationship that is a relationship initiated by his grace and responded to through our faith. So by faith, let us come to the table with the Lord. If Christ is in you, if you have received him as Savior and Lord, if you have allowed his spirit to have residency in your life, if you are his and he is yours, then he welcomes you to the table. Now, if there is some unfinished business between you and someone else, he says, oh, wait, let's not do this right now. You go and make that right first and then come and let's break bread together. So, you know, he leaves that with each one of us, but he calls us to himself and to remember him and what he has done for us. So if you are in Christ and he is in you, if you're part of the family of God, let us join together with Jesus in that upper room where Jesus, after giving thanks to the Father, he took bread and broke it, saying, this is my body. It is given for you. Take and eat, all of you. And as often as you do this, remember me. Let us remember our Lord, who never forgets us. In like manner, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, Jesus said, this is my blood. It is of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take this, all of you, and drink it. And as often as you do this, remember me. The blood, the life of our Lord Jesus, who gives us life. Lord Jesus, thank you for coming into this broken world to live a life that is perfect, to live a life that was humble and submissive to the Father, to do for us what we really deserve, and that is the accountability for our own sins. But you take that account onto yourself and you pay the price. Thank you. Lord, as we have felt kicked to the curb sometimes in life, and wanting to get even or get back, help us to remember you, that you don't seek to get even or get back. What you seek is reconciliation and restoration. So we yield ourselves to you in a fresh way, Lord. We love you because you first loved us. Help us then to allow that love to work in us and through us to those around us, no matter how we might be treated, giving that love just as you have given it freely. In your name, amen. Now, brothers and sisters, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Now let us go out and be peacemakers in a world that needs that more than anything. God bless you all. Thank you. Great to see you.
Thank you. Have a good day.